we have adopted during the lockdown. We have been conducting such online counseling classes since about a month. Many of you have been regularly attending to our online sessions. In this particular course on marketing management, we have conducted about 3 or 4 sessions prior to this session. We have discussed about the various concepts related to marketing management. We have discussed about the consumer buying behavior, decision-making process. We have already discussed about segmentation, targeting, positioning strategies. In the class scheduled yesterday, we have discussed about the product mix strategies as well as the new product development strategies. So in this session, we are going to discuss about pricing. Right? We know most of us or many of the customers or consumers, they are highly price sensitive. So what should be the appropriate pricing strategy for the products or services? We are going to discuss about this in this particular session. For this session, we have with us Dr. Dharanjay Beura, Principal, Kostubh Group of Kostubh Business School. He is currently working as the principal in Kostubh Business School. He has 7 years of industry experience and 10 years of teaching experience. He is a pharmacy graduate and has also completed his postgraduate diploma in management from one of the top rated B school in India, that is Jaipuria Institute of Management, Lucknow. He has completed his PhD in marketing management. He has worked with Eli Lilly, and he was also the bank manager of ICICI. He has a lot of experience both in the field of academics as well as industry. So we are fortunate to have Dr. Beura with us. We also have our colleague from Odisha State Open University, Srimay sir. He has been a great resource in scheduling the classes and in smooth functioning and conduction of the online classes. He is a great asset for the university as well. So without any further delay, I extend my warm welcome to all the participants and the resource person for the session, Dr. Beura, and all my colleagues from Odisha State Open University. And I request Dr. Beura to take over and deliver his lecture. Over to you, sir.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Dr. Anshuman Jena. Good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon, Srimay sir. It's a privilege to join Odisha State Open University sessions for the first time.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, thank you, everyone. Well, I have been given the opportunity to take a session on pricing. I think most of the topics on marketing has been discussed with all of you. Basically, one thing I would like to remind all of you, which is one of the most important aspect of marketing, that is marketing mix. I hope you all remember that is product, price, place, and promotion, right? This is what marketing mix is all about. So when we talk about these 4 concepts, there is a service marketing mix even. So we'll talk only about goods. So if it is about goods, there are product, price, place, and promotion we are saying as marketing mix. Okay. Now we'll talk about that out of these 4. Now, the learners who are there, because in a physical class, we get to know each other about your background and all. So it's easier for us to explain. through online media will assume most of the thing that you understand, the aspects, and that is how we are going to explain you. So I'll talk to you in generalized form only. I'll not give any specific example to make you understand. Rather, I'll give you generalized examples so that you can understand. Overall, everyone can understand it well. Let's take it in a very simplified manner. That suppose you are starting a business tomorrow. Now, what is the first thing you do? The first thing, you develop a product, right? You do a market research. You find that, you know, today, suppose, you know, current scenario. Let's take current scenario. Current scenario, we are suppose everyone need a hand sanitizer, right? So you got to know that, you know, there is a demand of hand sanitizer. So what will you do? You are interested to enter into business. So what will you do? You'll develop a hand sanitizer, right? Now, what is the first thing you'll do in that after developing the product? The product is developed. Now what will you do? You'll basically try to find out what would be the price of this particular product, right? So that is one of the most important critical decision for any marketing person, right? So all over the world, any strategist, when they have been given a responsibility of pricing, that they always say it is one of the biggest headache for any strategist. But today we'll make it very simple that you all can also design price for any product you want for yourself, right? So we'll take the example of hand sanitizer today, right? Now, what will you do? You'll do first, you know, a survey where you'll try to find out what is the current market price of hand sanitizer. Isn't that true? Right. First, you will try to find out what are the products available and what are the prices they are charging for it. Now, for example, I'll give you a live example where, you know, I bought a Dettol small hand sanitizer for my daughter. It was costing me 25 ml, 39 rupees around 2 months back. Right now, they are selling it at 100 ml, 30 rupees. Right. Why the price was earlier 25 ml 39 rupees and now it is 100 ml 30 rupees? What is the reason behind the price difference and how Dettol decided this price? That is what we are going to understand during this session. So for your for your better understanding, I have given some example that price is all around us. Wherever you look at, there is a price. You are paying rent for your house, that is a price. You are paying tuition fee, that is a price. You are paying airline fees, railways, everything. So everywhere there is a price, right? So everything we see now, there are two aspects to it again. We get certain, nowadays price is most important undoubtedly, but nowadays people are looking so many non-price factors that if I am going by an airline, I'm paying price for what? Traveling from one place to another. But along with it, what else I am getting, right? What are the, suppose you'll go inside the, you know, aircraft and the cabin crew will misbehave with you. So you have paid the price for traveling in that airline, but you have not paid, the cabin crew is going to misbehave with you. Then in that case, what will happen? You'll feel like it is your whatever price you have paid, that is a waste. But if you'll enter inside the fly aircraft and the cabin crew is welcoming you with a beautiful smile and, you know, some beautiful gifts they are offering, you will feel like that is a priceless, we say, you know, priceless experience. So there are so many non-price things always attached to a certain product or services. So the next part, these are few examples. If you can go to the next one, this is the only element. Now let's understand this particular slide. Very interesting. Now, as I told you that in marketing mix, product is there, price is there, place is there, promotion is there. If you see, everything is incurring a cost. Product, you are incurring a cost. While distribution, you are incurring a cost. While doing promotion, you are incurring a cost. But one thing is that price, which earns you a revenue. right? So this is the only element in the marketing mix that brings in revenues. All the rest are cost. Price communicates the value positioning of the product. Let's understand what is the difference between what is value and what is a price. Now, it is a big difference between value and price. Now, what is a value? The benefits you are deriving by paying certain price, the benefits you are deriving out of a product by paying certain price is known as value. Now, the benefit may vary from my point of view to your point of view, right? Suppose I buy one mobile phone where, you know, the mobile phone is costing 10,000 rupees for me. You pay about the same mobile phone, it is costing 10,000 for you, right? Now let's understand value. Now for me, the mobile phone is the only source of communication, right? I would like to communicate with someone else. So I need to check the voice clarity with the mobile phone. But for you, suppose the photograph, while if you'll take a photo, it is, you are getting a clear image, right? That is the thing you are looking into that mobile phone. If you'll not get a clear image in that mobile phone, you'll feel like it's not of so much value to you, right? So the benefit you derived out of that mobile phone is, we both bought same mobile phone, but the benefit you derived and I derived is completely different. So looking at all these, we'll talk about value little more later on. What is a value and what is a perceived value? We'll talk about that a little later. So that is what price brings in revenues. So next slide. A firm must set a price for the first time when it develops a new product, right? When it develops a new product, they set a price for it. And when they make it enter into the distribution channel and in different geographical area, the price may be different, right? Whatever the price at Bhubaneswar, suppose house rent. Imagine about house rent at Bhubaneswar and house rent at Mumbai. It is completely different. Same 1 BHK you are getting here at 5,000 rupees, there you will get at 25,000 rupees. So that is what the price difference on the basis of geographical area. So the company is going to decide the product price mostly on the basis of the different geographical area, on the basis of distribution channel. Some product may be costing, even if you see, look at the commodity price, petrol. Now the petrol price at, you know, the petrol price at Cuttack and Bhubaneswar is different. The petrol price at Cuttack and Bhubaneswar may be somewhere around 15 paisa difference is there. Why? Because distribution channel expenses are included into it. If the distribution, you know, the petrol distribution is coming through Cuttack to Bhubaneswar, then there is some extra mile which the transporter is covering. That is what they are charging extra. So that is how they decide the price. Okay, let's go to the next one. So as I told you that, you know, company has to, it is one of the most difficult tasks for any company to decide price. But so as I told you that, you know, if it is about hand sanitizer, we'll take the example of hand sanitizer. You are developing a hand sanitizer tomorrow and you'll keep the price, suppose, at 200 rupees per 100 ml, per 500 rupees per liter, you'll keep it. Then the customer will look at that whether I'm getting 500 rupees per liter, I'm getting the same value as I'm buying some other product at suppose 700 rupees per liter, whether I'm getting the same value. So it all depends on customer's perception. Perceived is the perception. On the basis of their perception, they'll decide that whether I should pay. I say, anyone can tell me that why are you paying 200 rupees for a Parker pen, wherein a Link pen you are buying at 20 rupees. And if I'll offer you a Link pen at 200 rupees, you will hesitate to buy. Isn't that true? Because you perceive that Parker pen should value at 200 rupees and Link pen should value at 20 rupees. That is your perception. Now tomorrow, if I'll sell you a Parker pen at 20 rupees, will you buy it? Most of you will say it is a duplicate product, maybe, because you have developed a perception that, you know, Parker pen would always cost very high. That is the perception, because you feel like the value you are deriving out of Parker pen is very high. So let's go to the consumer psychology, looking at why a Parker pen we are ready to pay 200 rupees, why a Link pen we are ready to pay only 20 rupees. Let's understand consumer psychology and pricing. From there you can understand this. The first is reference price. Now when hello, yeah, so let's understand about reference price. Now see, anytime as per market research by McKinsey, they said that, you know, most of the people usually forget when they go to a market to buy a certain product, they usually forget the cost of a product which they saw somewhere. For example, I went to market to buy a mobile phone. I liked a mobile phone. Now I'll think about what would be the cost of this mobile phone. Now, how can I think about the cost of the shop owner or shopkeeper is saying this mobile phone is costing you 15,000 rupees. Now you are going to evaluate it that whether it should cost 15,000. How can you evaluate? You'll take certain reference price. Reference price is usually of two ways. One is you'll take your internal reference, your previous experience, right? Another is external reference. You will compare it with some other phones, right? Whether I should buy it at 15,000 or not, you will always compare. Internal reference, you will see your past experience, maybe that, you know, earlier phone I bought at 10,000 rupees, I was getting all these benefits. Now I am buying at 15,000 rupees and I am getting all these benefits. So I look into the internal reference as well. I look into the external reference. This is a Vivo mobile phone. You know, what is the price difference as compared to a Samsung mobile phone? If there is a big price difference, why the big price difference? So you will always refer to certain other price. That is called reference price. On that basis only you can decide that I should buy this mobile phone at this price or I should not buy, right? So I gave you the example of hand sanitizer. Even if you are developing a new product, you want to price it, then you will always take the reference of the other product. That Dettol product is available at which price? Your Savlon is available at which price? You will compare all those price and then you can decide the price. Now, another interesting aspect to it, that is called price quality inferences. Now, price quality inferences is why I'm saying it is one of the most interesting aspect. There is a very interesting research on it. The research is, you know, if you are going to sell your hand sanitizer tomorrow, you will say this is the best hand sanitizer available in the world and it is available at only per liter 50 rupees. Is there anyone who is going to believe you? And someone is saying the hand sanitizer I'm selling is at 1000 rupees per liter. Both are sitting side by side. One is selling 1 liter at 50 rupees. One is selling 1 liter as 1000 rupees. And you have mentioned here, this is the best quality in the world. And the other person who is selling at 1000 rupees, he has not mentioned anything. Believe you me, you all are going to buy 1 liter at 1000 rupees hand sanitizer. Why? Because it is a usual psychology that people always believe high price, high quality, low price, low quality. It never matches. You know, you can never say that high price and low quality and low price and high quality never matches with each other, right? So tomorrow you are into any business and you are keeping at a very low price, and if you say that it is the highest quality, people will not believe you, right? Suppose Mercedes-Benz, for example. Mercedes-Benz, someone will say, is available at Maruti's price. Now people will say it is a duplicate Mercedes-Benz. They will not buy it, right? And someone will charge Maruti at a Mercedes price. Will you buy it? You will never buy it, right? So that is what happens in price quality inferences. Hopefully everyone understood the consumer psychology. It's a consumer psychology that if you charge very high, people will believe that it is having good quality. But again, there is some limitation to it. It is not like, you'll charge 1 lakh rupees for 1 liter hand sanitizer and people will buy it. It is not like that. There is a limitation to it. We'll understand about that limitation later on. Now, let's understand the next part, that is called price cues. Now, what is a price cue? Cue means hint. When someone get a hint. Now, what is a price cue? What we say that you have visited Bata showroom, right? What they do? They keep it at 299.95 rupees, right? So 299.95 rupees, and someone at Sri Leather showroom, suppose, mentioned at 301 rupees for the same design shoe. And believe you me, it's only a difference of, if you see value, price wise, it is only a difference of 1 rupee 5 paisa, right? But people will always go for 299.95 because they believe it is below 300, right? Below 300, it always looks cheaper. Suppose someone is charging 300 rupees even, you will not go to 300 showroom. 299.95 you will go there because you will feel like it is much cheaper than the 300 rupees. Wherein it is not much cheaper, it is just 5 paisa, which is not of much difference. Because the consumer psychology always encode the price from left to right. Left to right, in the sense, you look at 299.95, left side is 2 written, and when you keep 300, it is, suppose, 300 is higher price, well, let's take it a lower price. If it is at 900 rupees and 899 rupees, similar price, similar thing. Left to right, you look at the left to right, the left side is lower value, then you will always feel like it is cheaper. Means 299, so 2 is less than, much less than 3, you believe, right? But 299 and 300 is only 1 rupee difference. It is not of much difference, but you always believe that it is most economical. That is what called price cues. So this is all about consumer psychology. The next slide is talking about higher price, which I gave you an example, that higher price and lower perceived value. Suppose someone has kept a price very high, but the customers are perceiving it at a very economical one it should be. Matlab, if you are selling a mobile phone at 20,000 rupees and customer is perceiving that it should cost somewhere around 7,000 to 8,000 rupees. In that case, company usually misses potential profit, company ka loss hota hai, kyunki company could not identify the perceived value, that what should be the perceived value of this, right? That is where company lose its profit. So that is why you have to always do proper market survey to find out what is the value customer is perceiving about your product. If customer is perceiving that it should be at 7,000 to 8,000, but you are keeping at 20,000, customer will never buy it, right? So that is why higher price plus lower perceived value, always company misses the potential profit. Next slide. Again, another interesting slide, lower price plus lower perceived value. Company fails to harvest potential profit. Means if you have kept a lower price, and customer also think like it should be of lower price, then in that case, company can never book profit. क्योंकि यू आर सेलिंग एट ए लोअर प्राइस, लाइक इट शुड बी ए सस्ता टाइप ऑफ प्रोडक्ट, वेरी लो वैल्यू प्रोडक्ट, राइट, देन इन दैट केस कंपनी कैन नेवर हार्वेस्ट प्रॉफिट, राइट. सो दैट इज अगेन अनदर कंज्यूमर साइकोलॉजी. नेक्स्ट स्लाइड प्लीज. नाउ व्हाट वी से, प्राइस इज इक्वल टू कॉस्ट प्लस प्रॉफिट. प्राइस शुड ऑलवेज बी इक्विवेलेंट टू वॉट एवर द कॉस्ट. नाउ वी टूक द एग्जाम्पल ऑफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर, right? If I'll make a hand sanitizer and the cost is somewhere around 80 rupees per 100 ml, I want a profit of 20 rupees, so the price should be at 100 rupees. The cost is included. What all cost we'll discuss in detail later on. Next slide. So let's understand the process of pricing, how the company decide the process, right? Now more than the slide, please try to concentrate on whatever I'm explaining, because the slide is only mentioned the points. Now we'll discuss each and every point about it. The first point, it is saying selecting the pricing objective. We'll select the pricing objective. That what is your objective? If the objective is please go to the next slide. The objectives are mentioned. If the objective of the company is survival, the company want to survive in the market, then they'll keep the price at a certain level that they'll be able to survive in the market. Where it happens? If the market, there is a huge competition, fierce competition is fierce, in that case the company always, the new entrant or the competitor, the followers always follow the survival strategy, right? They always look at that how they can survive in this market, right? Now if you'll go for a hand sanitizer manufacturing, because so many companies have entered into sanitizer products, that if you'll enter into sanitizer and if you'll keep a very high price, no one will buy. Because now you need to survive in the market. There is a huge competition, right? But again, there is a fixed cost involved into it, and there is a variable cost. Let's see, we'll come to that later on. Let's understand the objective, then we'll discuss about that. The next objective, it is saying maximum current profit. The company want to book maximum current profit. In that case, they'll keep the price little higher to book maximum current profit, but that is again short term gain, right? There are so many companies who try to book maximum current profit by short term gain. Now dekho, what happened now, the corona COVID-19 problem was going on, so many companies launched their product and they knowingly kept it at a very high price because they wanted a short term current, you know, maximize their current profit. But what will happen now, so many players enter into hand sanitizer business, now customer has many option. What customer will never buy your high priced sanitizer? They will immediately move to your low priced sanitizers. So maximizing current profit is always short term profit. So never go for maximizing current profit, always look for long term profit. Another is called as maximum market share. Please try to understand this particular concept. This is lifelong. It will be very helpful for you, useful for you to understand market, how to maximize market share. It is also called as a penetration pricing strategy. Maximum market share is also called as penetration pricing strategy. So what is a market penetration pricing strategy? It is basically long run profit. That means you will keep a very low price while launching the product and you'll try to enter the maximum market, right? So when you'll keep a low price, people will buy at rural places even, not only urban places, they will buy at rural places even. If they will buy at rural places, obviously your market share would be more. That is why Dettol reduced the sanitizer price. Every company increase the sanitizer price, but Dettol reduced the sanitizer price because they wanted to penetrate into every corner of the country, right? That is maximizing market share or long-term profit they wanted to book, right? So people will be loyal towards that brand, that they are charging low price at difficult time. So people will be always loyal towards that particular brand, right? That is called market penetration strategy, which is being followed by most of the companies in India, right? Whenever they launch product, they always look at rural market, because we have a 70% rural market, which is a huge market. And if you can enter into rural market, then your market share would be much higher than the competitors, right? Let's go to the next one, that is maximizing market skimming. Again, technical term. Whenever there is a technical term, I'll explain you in a simplified manner so that you can understand it. Now, skimming strategy. You understand skimming? Skimming is usually when we extract butter out of milk. That is called skimming, right? How do you extract butter out of milk? You keep your stirring machine in between the milk, right? And then you rotate it with a speed. Then you skim the milk, right? This is what you do when you extract butter. Similarly, when you enter into the market, when you keep very high price right at the beginning, and you will capture the central market. Central market is the rich segment, right? The people who are having very high, high worth, net worth people. You will capture those high net worth people by keeping the price very high. And this strategy, I'll give you an example and you will understand easily. Sony usually follow this strategy, that when they launched their, Sony TV, flat TV, they kept it at 70,000-80,000 rupees for that TV. So what they did, they captured the high net worth individuals first. By that, what happened, the image of the product goes up. Everyone at, middle class people, they always look at that, okay, this is costing 70,000-80,000 rupees. Whenever the price will come down, I'll buy this. And then what Sony does, that they develop another new product. And the old product, they reduce the price all of a sudden. Did you understand? The TV which was costing 80,000 rupees, they'll reduce it to 40. You'll see always Sony TV, you'll see the market always. They have done like this every time. 83,000 rupees at the beginning, and all of a sudden they'll go down to 43,000. But by that time, they develop another new product, and that new product will again cost 83,000 rupees or 90,000 rupees. So all those people who aspired to own that product, who had seen a dream that one day I'll own that product of 83,000, when they saw in the market it is available at 43,000, they'll immediately buy it, right? So their market share will immediately increase. That is what called market skimming strategy, right? So this is another pricing strategy which premium products they usually follow. Another is called as product quality leadership. Product quality leadership is basically some company, they are always try to keep high price, and they never reduce their price. That is price, product quality leadership, right? They are basically leader in that particular product segment, and they keep the product price at a very high price always, so that people always believe if you want quality product, you don't have any problem in paying the price, then you should go for this particular product, right? So all these high status product, they are always keep they always believe, people always believe that their product quality leadership is there in that particular segment. Okay, that is the first step, that you selected what is the pricing objective. Hope everyone understood. We'll recapitulate the points little bit again, because unless and until you understand that, you cannot understand the next part. The pricing objective was, the first pricing objective was survival, where the company want to survive. The second objective is maximizing current profit. This is always short-run profit. The third objective is maximize market share. You want to capture more and more market. And long run, you will book profit. That is what long run profit. And the fourth one is maximizing market skimming. You want to capture the net worth, high net worth individuals. You want to keep a very high quality product and high price product. And gradually, you will reduce the price all of a sudden so that you will capture maximum market share. And the last one is product quality leadership. Now, when we have decided the objective, we will go to the next part, that is determining demand. Now, all the learners, hopefully you understand one thing, that demand, price is always dependent on demand. For example, right now during this COVID-19 crisis, so many products, they increase the price because the demand is more. If the price is also increased, you are buying it. You are never negotiating with the shopkeeper, or you are never changing your attitude for any other product, because you need that product at any cost. In case of commodities, it happens usually, like your onion, potato, when you buy during this crisis, they increase it to 40 rupees per kg. Then also you don't ask a single question. You buy it, right? Onion, yes, of course. When onion price went up, so many people stopped eating onion. That is the only way out you can do. Otherwise, you know, the price is always dependent on demand of the product. So each price will lead to a different level of demand and have a different impact on company's marketing objective. Now, very interesting is demand and price are always inversely related. Inversely related means when you'll keep a high price, the demand would be low. When there is a low price, the demand would be high. But it is not always true. When you'll see that high price always keep a high price will keep, the demand would be low, and low price will keep, the demand would be high. That is not always true, because in certain cases, the higher price, the in certain cases like prestige goods, where the goods are attached with certain kind of status or prestige, then in that case, high price you'll keep, and the demand would be more. Anyone can think of any example like where you'll keep high, you'll increase the price and the demand would be more? Especially these are the cases of prestige good like perfumes, where you'll increase the price and people will feel like, you know, it must be a better perfume, right? So they buy more. So that is, again, there is a limitation to it. But again, we have to look into another concept while determining demand. The concept is called as sensitivity. I told you, there is a limitation to it, that if you increase the price, then up to certain extent, the demand will not go down. And after certain extent, the demand will go down. When you decrease the price, up to certain extent, the demand will go up. And after certain extent, the demand will not go up, right? Suppose the sanitizer price was per liter 500 rupees. Now it came down to per liter 400 rupees. People will buy more. Those people who were washing their hand with soaps, they will shift to your sanitizer, right? Now you'll keep the price at 300 rupees. Some more people will buy, so the demand would be more. But if you keep at 100 rupees per liter, no one will buy, because they'll believe that it may not work. The sanitizer is not of good quality. So how can we check the sensitivity? That is called price sensitivity. The sensitivity level at which one customer don't follow the price strategies. Right, so that is called price elasticity of demand. Now, The price elasticity of demand is basically of two types. One is elastic in nature and another is inelastic in nature. Elastic in nature, when, please try to understand this particular concept. This is very important. Price elasticity. Now, suppose there is a product which is costing 15 rupees. You reduce the price to 10 rupees, right? And the volume in sale of that particular product did not increase much. It only increased 5 rupees. Suppose the price of a product was 15 rupees. You reduce the price to 10 rupees. 150, the product was being sold 150. You reduce the price to suppose 10 rupees and people were buying 50. Now they are buying 150. So in that case, what happens? The elasticity is there in that product, right? So when there is no change in demand, we call it inelastic demand. Now I'll give you certain example for making it simpler. Now suppose petrol price will go up by 10 rupees. Will you not use petrol anymore? Do you think the demand will go down? Never. It will never go down, right? Yes, of course. At certain point, when the petrol price would be 200 rupees per liter, you know, people may use some other substitute, right? Otherwise, they are never going to change themselves, right? Now, sugar price, all this commodity, when the price change happens, the demand usually don't change much. So there is inelastic in nature. But when something you like a juice was costing, suppose, 100 rupees, so you were never buying it, right? The demand was less. The juice is now costing, suppose, ek mein ek free mil gaya. So 50 rupees, now you will buy that juice because you believe that, you know, 50 rupees mein mil gaya, so I'll buy it again. So that is how the demand went up. So that is elastic in nature. So you have to check the price sensitivity or price elasticity of demand. Now, what are the factors what influences price sensitivity? Now we have to check that the factor whether if I'm buying a product and the product what I'm buying that is being shared by, you know, someone else, then in that case the price sensitivity is not much there. For example, I'll give you an example and you'll very well understand. Suppose you are buying a product for your office, right? You'll not look into the price much. Isn't that true? But the same product you are buying for your home will always look into the price. So there is a sensitivity. So same product, in both the case, one case it is elastic in nature, in another case it is inelastic in nature. That influences a price sensitivity. Hopefully you understood this concept of shared cost. Sunk investment. Product is basically used as a complementary to another purchase. In that case, again, the price sensitivity is not there. Suppose you are buying a toothpaste and with this, they are giving you a toothbrush free of cost, right? You will not look into the price of the toothbrush at all, right? So that is called sunk investment. Inventory effect, buyers cannot store the product. If you cannot keep the product for a longer duration, in that case also price sensitivity is there, right? Milk product, right? You cannot keep it for a longer duration. So you cannot buy, suppose someone will say, you buy 100 liter milk today, I'll give you at 10 rupees per liter. Will you buy it? You'll never buy it, right? Wherein you'll buy it at 50 rupees per liter, but you'll never buy it at 10 rupees per liter because you cannot store 100 liter milk, right? So that is again another important influence factor which influences the price sensitivity. So isliye milk mein, if they increase the price to 4 rupees also, you have to buy it, right? If they'll decrease the price, you will not buy more milk. Nothing will change, right? Then items bought more frequently. When items you are buying very frequently, for example, your bathing soap, your oil, hair oil, your edible oils, which you are buying very frequently. And if there is a price change, you are very sensitive to it, right? So if tomorrow you'll go to buy a Dove soap and the Dove soap is costing you 100 rupees, will you buy it? Will you immediately stop buying it? Will look for the substitute, right? So items bought more frequently, usually people are very sensitive towards its price, right? You all have to understand this particular factors. It is not a theoretical thing. It is absolutely practical thing. Whenever you will start any business or you will enter into any corporate where you have to decide the pricing strategy, you have to look into all these factors and then only you can decide the price. That is why it is important to determine demand. And to determine demand, you have to look into the variables what are influencing those demand sensitivity. Now you'll again look into the unique value effect. If the product has certain unique value, if the product is unique in nature, if that is prestigious product, there is something exclusive, someone will give you a patented product, they'll keep a very high price, then also you'll buy it. Because the price sensitivity usually you are not there when it is a unique product, right? Substitute awareness by buyers. If buyers are aware of substitutes, ki sanitizer ki jagah pe agar I'll use a bathing soap, then also it works. You know, then substitute awareness is there. Then what will happen? People will be sensitive, very sensitive towards the price. If Dettol will increase, Dettol soap, they'll increase the price to 40 rupees tomorrow, you'll not buy Dettol. You'll not look into the germ killing effect of Dettol. You'll look into Lifebuoy, right? Immediately you'll shift, right? That is what substitute awareness by buyers. Difficult comparison by buyers. When buyers are not able to compare it easily, right? If I'll ask you to buy one laptop, you are not technically proficient to check what are the softwares in that laptop. In that case, it is difficult for you to evaluate ki why this laptop is costing more, why this laptop is costing less. So sensitivity is usually less in that case, right? End benefit, expenditure, small part of total income. Means end benefit, if it is end benefit you feel like is very high, then you will not be sensitive towards the price. If you feel like the end benefit is less, means whatever the end benefit you are getting, then it is less, then obviously you are not sensitive, you are sensitive towards it. Now total expenditure, purchase cost is insignificant compared to the cost of end product. Now total expenditure of buying that product, if it's very high, then you'll, and whatever the end product, so for example, tomorrow you decided to manufacture hand sanitizer at your home, right? Now, if for that someone will suggest you buy a machine which is costing 10 lakh rupees and manufacture a hand sanitizer, but you'll be able to sell only 100 liter with that particular hand sanitizer, will you invest that money? No. If the total cost of the end product is less as compared to the total expenditure, then obviously people are very sensitive about the price, right? Low cost items, less sensitive. High cost items, usually more sensitive. When it is low cost item, it is usually less sensitive because people are not very much worried if tomorrow detergent soap was 12 rupees, now it is 11 rupees. Will you think much about it? Not at all. But when it is high cost item, you are very sensitive about it, right? You wanted to buy a perfume and the perfume was costing 500 rupees. Now it is costing, suppose, 300 rupees. Now you'll buy it, right? You are highly sensitive, right? One second. Okay, now let's we have discussed about price elastic and inelastic already. Let's move to the next one. I've already discussed, so let's go to the next. It's not required. Okay, we'll come to this. How to estimate cost? This is again the most important aspect of pricing, that how to estimate cost. Basically, as I gave you at the beginning, that you want to set up a hand sanitizer factory, right? So what will you look at? First, you'll look at the fixed cost. Then what are the fixed investment you are going to make? For example, you'll 2000 square feet, one production center you'll make. So what is the rent for it, right? The machineries you'll buy, what are the fixed cost, the machineries you'll buy. So these are all are fixed investment what you are going to make. Now variable cost is again you are procuring the raw materials, right? You are paying the salaries. These are all, you know, depending on the number of employees you recruit. So those are going to vary, right, time to time, variable cost. Now we'll understand learning curve, activity-based costing, and target costing. We'll understand all this estimating cost. Let's understand with the concept of fixed cost and variable cost how the price is decided. Right. Next slide, please. We'll talk about little bit. Okay, let me explain you the first fixed cost, variable cost, and all, and then I'll come to this. Okay, now I have already explained you that what is a fixed cost and what is a variable cost. Now, fixed cost is usually also called as overhead cost, overhead expenses they mention usually, and variable cost. So total cost is usually fixed cost plus variable cost, right? Now there is something called as short run average cost and another is called as long run average cost. What is short run average cost and what is long run average cost? When suppose you are manufacturing 1000 bottles of hand sanitizer, right? Your fixed cost is suppose 1 lakh rupees and your variable cost is suppose 50,000 rupees. So 1,50,000 rupees is the total cost you are incurring, right? So you manufacture 1000 bottle of sanitizer. So if you divide it by 1000 bottle, how much it will become? 1,50,000 divided by 1000, right? So it will cost 150 rupees, right? 150 rupees per bottle it is costing you. Now suppose you will manufacture 2000 bottle, what will happen? 1,50,000 divided by 2000. So again, it will become 75 rupees, right? So which was costing you 150 rupees, because you increase the production as fixed cost remain constant, but variable cost will go up little bit. But at the same time, what happened? You produce more, so the cost went down, right? But do you think in that case, you will calculate that if tomorrow I'll manufacture 5,000 bottle, then it will cost, you know, minimum 1,50,030 rupees only. So that will never happen. Why? Because after a certain time period, means after manufacturing of 2,000 bottle, your workers will become fatigued, means tired. So what will happen? Their efficiency will go down. So gradually your production will go down and your cost will go up, because you will incur electric cost, you will incur machine cost, depreciation cost. So there are so many other raw material wastage. So there are so many other aspects to it. So after certain time period, your cost will go up. So you have to decide what is that average cost at which you are able to produce maximum, right? So that is called short run average cost. In long run average cost, similarly, if you'll set up another factory, in this factory, if I'm manufacturing 2000 bottle, then it is giving me best profit. Now another factory I'll form where I'll manufacture another 2000 bottle, then again you are getting good profit. Another factory you set up and again 2000, again you are booking good profit. But how many factories you can set up again? Again, more people, there would be more challenge for you. So at certain point of time, what will happen? You'll incur loss. So that average, again, you have to find out that what is the long run average cost. If the long run average cost is 6,000, that at 6,000 bottle, you'll get maximum profit, then only you should go for it, right? Okay, this is about fixed cost and variable cost. What is a learning curve? Then this is a little technical again. Now, suppose your workers are able to manufacture today 1,000 bottle of hand sanitizer, right? Now, the next first batch, they are manufacturing 1,000 bottle of hand sanitizer. If we'll go for the next batch, at less time, they'll manufacture more hand sanitizer. Why? Because they got to learn so many shortcuts while manufacturing, right? So they'll omit their waste steps. For example, you know, earlier they were procuring raw materials, they were going to storehouse to procure raw material, they were bringing it to the platform, then they were manufacturing it. Later on, what they did, they got all the raw materials from store to the production setup, and gradually they formed one by one, they manufactured 1,000 liters of sanitizer. What will happen? Less time, more production. So that is called learning curve with experience. What will happen? Your efficiency will go up. That is called learning curve. Activity-based costing. This is called ABC analysis. This is very interesting, and nowadays every company is doing ABC analysis. That is called activity-based costing. So for each and every activity, what is the cost incurred by company? That is called activity-based costing. So for particular procurement activity, what is the cost they are incurring? For raw material movement or supply chain activity, what is the cost they are incurring? For each activity, they'll look into the costing and then they'll find out the cost. Then target costing. The management will decide a target that, you know, the price should be at this level. So that is called target costing. Anshuman sir, what time should I close this topic?
Sir, we can continue up to 4:45.
Okay. Okay, fine. 15 minutes more I can discuss. Okay. Now target costing. Now very interesting target costing. I'll give you an interesting example about target costing. Now target costing is, you know, Patanjali does target costing basically. You know, Swami Ramdev tried to find out that what is the best mustard oil in market available. Engine mustard oil he saw. So engine mustard oil, what is the price of engine mustard oil? It is costing 135 rupees per liter, right? So Swami Ramdev went to his production setup and said that I need a product equivalent to engine quality or maybe better than engine quality at a price 130 rupees. Is that possible? Then the production people will work on it. So they got a target of manufacturing the mustard oil at 130 rupees only with the same design, better quality. So that is where this happens. Yes. So that is what happens in estimating cost, right? Okay, we'll go to the pricing methods. I'll quickly take you through the markup pricing. Please go to the next slide. This is a little bit looking mathematical, but it is not mathematical. It is very simple calculation. One unit cost of a product, we usually can find out a variable cost plus fixed cost upon unit sale. For example, a pen manufacturer, suppose the variable cost per unit of pen manufacturing is 10 rupees, fixed cost is 3 lakh rupees, expected sales is 50,000, then what would be the unit cost? Unit cost would be rupees 10 is the variable cost, plus fixed cost is 3 lakh rupees, divided by 50,000, that is rupees 16 is the unit cost, right? Assume the manufacturer want to earn a profit of 20% markup on sales, right? Markup is the profit. They want to book a profit of 20%. What will they do? Markup price is equal to unit cost upon 1 minus desired rate of return. Means 1 minus 20% is 0.2. So 16 rupees divided by 1 minus 0.2 is equal to 20 rupees. So iska MRP kya hua? 20 rupees they will keep, right? The price they will keep at 20 rupees. Hope everyone understood. They're very simple formulation. Then target return pricing. This is the next method of pricing strategy. Suppose a pen manufacturer has invested 10 lakh rupees in the business, right? And wants to set a price to earn a 20% return on investment. Means jo 10 lakh usne invest kiya, they want to book a profit of 20%, right? Now, what is the target return price? Target return price is equal to unit cost plus desired return into invested capital upon unit sales. Unit cost plus desired return into invested capital upon unit sales. That is rupees 16. That is not equal to, that is rupees 16 plus. By mistake I made it equal to, that is rupees 16 plus rupees 20 into invested capital is 10 lakh divided by 50,000. Again, I repeat, unit cost is 16 rupees plus desired return is how much? 20% is the desired return into 10 lakh divided by 50,000. That will, you'll get 20 rupees as the target return price. Now, but it is, how can you predict that you'll get a 50,000 sales? This is the sales is 50,000. We have assumed that the sales should be 50,000. If it is less than 50,000, then the price would go up, right? So we need to find out the break-even volume. Break-even volume in the sense, at what volume your price, your profit, you will not book, neither you will book profit nor you will book loss, right? That is the break-even volume, right? At the certain point where your profit, there will be no profit, no loss, right? It is very important for a businessman to find out the break-even volume, because from there only they can calculate that what would be the profit after this. You know, a single increase in volume is always the company's profit, right? So fixed cost upon price minus variable cost. So fixed cost is suppose 3 lakh in previous cases, upon price is 20 rupees minus variable cost is 10 rupees. So that is 30,000. So we considered that 50,000 is the unit sales, but 30,000, up to 30,000, you will not book any profit or any loss, right? And after 30,000, when you'll sell 31,000, that 1,000 is your profit. Did you understand? Hopefully everyone is clear about this. Is little mathematical, but very simple. Now I'll go to the psychological pricing part. This is basically psychological pricing. Is you know, we need to understand the customer psychology for pricing, right? And the customer psychology is basically depend on perceived value pricing. Perceived value pricing, in the sense, we'll go to basically you'll go to suppose buy an Apple phone, and the Apple phone is costing 85,000 rupees. Now you'll ask, why the Apple phone is 85,000 rupees? The same configuration I'm getting at Vivo phone at 40,000 rupees. Why should I pay you 85,000 rupees? then what will happen? The psychological pricing is included there. The Apple brand itself, it gives a sense of guarantee in your mind that you are 100% secured with Apple phone, that you have attached with a brand. So for that brand, you are paying additional price, right? Maybe the configuration is equal, but for the guarantee kind of thought process, you are paying additional price. That is called psychological or perceived value pricing. Next slide, please. There are some new methods of pricing, like group pricing. Group pricing, when you know some of the people combine together and negotiate for buying another product, they usually negotiate hard. That is called group pricing, right? I'll give you an interesting example for this. Insurance. Suppose you will buy insurance for your entire company, right? Then what will happen? You'll always negotiate with the agent that there are 20 people who will do insurance. What will be the premium? And the insurance agent will always quote less premium. But if you'll go alone and will say that I would like to do an insurance, they'll always charge high premium, right? So that is called group pricing. Gain and risk sharing pricing means what is the gain and what is the risk you are taking for a particular product. If the gain and risk, gain is high and risk is high, then you'll always the company always highlight that the gain would be high and the risk would be less for this particular product. Then in that case, people are always interested to that particular purchasing that particular product. When gain is very high and risk is very low, you'll always go for that product, right? Okay, next. Geographical pricing. I told you at the beginning of the class that you know different pricing at different location. That is maybe certain product. There is a concept of barter counter trade in foreign currency that happens. Usually this happens in international trade. That suppose we bought certain product from US, right? Imported certain product from US. Now US will take the currency in dollar. They'll take $1 lakh, suppose. But rather than taking $1 lakh, US asked us that you give us hydroxychloroquine for this corona treatment, right? So government gave hydroxychloroquine against that $1 lakh import of certain other goods. That is called barter. This is not the old barter system. This is the new barter system where the foreign currency, in case of foreign currency exchange, this usually happens. Okay, next slide, please. I think these are some discounts and allowances usually also included in the part of pricing. Discount and allowances, like, whenever you go to a mall, you always find, you know, there is something called sale written, right? 40% sale. You believe that they'll give you a 40% discount on that product, right? Don't you think that the price which they included also includes profit? You know, there was a brand called Kutan, the Kutan garment. They were always giving a discount of 80%. And one day I was reading newspaper where I saw that they have booked a 40% profit in that particular year. See, they are giving 80% discount. Still, they are booking a 40% book profit. How? Because they include the price with those discounts. So it is all about different type of discounts and allowances. I think with this, I could give you a brief about pricing. Pricing is a vast subject. There are so many mathematical aspects to it. Still, within this time frame, we try to capture most of the important topics which is required for practical purpose of everyone. So that is how. Any question, please ask me. Someone asked, please explain learning curve. Okay, I'll explain your learning curve. Very interesting question. Now, learning curve is basically also otherwise called as experiential curve. Experiential curve in the sense, with the experience, your efficiency goes up, right? Suppose today you started manufacturing hand sanitizer, right? Today your workers started working on it. Today they manufactured 100 bottles. Tomorrow they'll manufacture definitely more bottles, right? 120 bottles. Day after tomorrow they'll manufacture again 140 bottles. Definitely they'll add 20 bottles more. So with the experience, the volume will always go up, right? And if the volume goes up, your cost would always go down. As the volume goes up, cost will go down, and definitely your price will go down. That is what is called as learning curve. Hopefully I'm clear. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Sir, we have another couple of questions.
Yes.
There is one question from Rakshi Sharma.
Yes, sir.
She is asking, what do you understand by demand for a product?
I didn't get what is written there in the chat. I'll go, yes, to sir. The chat. I'll look into the chat.
Yes. Yes, sir. Please go there. Question is there. Could you find it, sir?
Ankita Mishra. Rakhi Sharma, a company manufactures, yes, a product X, has the following cost. Variable cost rupees 10, fixed cost rupees 3 lakh, the company 300,000. The company expected to sell 50,000 units and wants to earn a 25% profit on average cost of production. What will be the break-even point in terms of volume production? Okay. For that, you have to again look into the formula which I told you, right? You have to first find out the unit cost of it, right? What is the unit cost of it? And then you have to find out what is the volume. So for that, sir, if you can take them to the formula, then again, because the values are almost same, what she has mentioned, so it is easier for them to be understood.
I'm just sharing the slide, sir.
Yes, yes.
Please give me some.
Your break-even volume is always fixed cost upon price minus variable cost, right? Whatever the fixed cost is, how much? 3 lakh you have mentioned, right? What is the price of that particular product you have mentioned? Price you have not mentioned here. The price you have not mentioned here. And you mention the price of the product. The price of that particular product minus variable cost. Variable cost is 10 rupees. The company expected to sell 50,000 units and wants to earn 25% profit on average cost of production. Okay, in that case also you can find out the price. The price is your unit cost you have to find out, right? Unit cost, because you have mentioned here the unit cost again, 50,000 unit you are saying, and you are saying the fixed cost is 3 lakh, the variable cost is rupees 10, you are saying, right? So rupees 10 is the variable cost per unit. So 50,000 unit is how much? 50,000 into rupees 10, that is 5 lakh, right? And the fixed cost is how much? 3 lakh. So per unit cost is how much? 8 lakh divided by 50,000, right? 8 lakh divided by 50,000, kar lo kitna aata hai? 16 rupees. 16 rupees you are getting, I think. So 16 rupees and you want to earn a 25% profit on average cost of production, right? 25% profit you want to book. So you can put this target return price. In that case, now unit cost is 16 rupees plus desired return is 25 into your invested capital is how much? 8 lakh. That is 8 lakh, and divided by your total unit is 50,000. So you'll get the MRP. Target return price. That is 25. Ke saath multiply karoge, you'll get some value. And in that, by using that formula, you can find out easily. There is not much difference in the problem you have given. So only 25 rupees is the difference. Any other question? In case the demand, Rakhi Sharma is asking a relevant question, but again, we have to do the calculation. For that, we need another 15-20 minutes to calculate and to find out. So if you can give
Sir, we can go to the next question.
Yes.
That is, why does a company initiate price change?
Okay, very interesting question again. Why does the company initiate price change? As I told you, that one of the influential variable, that is, you know, price is always associated with demand, right? The price, when price is associated with demand, if the demand goes up, then you have to reduce the price little bit to capture more and more market share. Now, that all again depend on the type of the product. What are the type of product you are dealing? Now, as I said that, you know, high price usually low demand and low price usually high demand, except certain product, other products like, so why a company will reduce the price? The company will reduce the price, that is called market penetration strategy. They'll try to enter more and more market share. In case of market skimming strategy, if the price is extraordinarily high price, they'll reduce the price all of a sudden so that they can capture a market share all of a sudden, right? So that is the reason basically behind, you know, capturing more and more market share, booking more and more profit, they initiate price change. If there is a change in raw material procurement, suppose raw material cost goes up, in that case again, the price company has to change because the raw material cost goes up. So definitely they have to change the price. I gave you example of Dettol hand sanitizer. Now the alcohol, which was earlier very costly, which is the key ingredient of a hand sanitizer, was very costly earlier. It was costing 300 rupees per liter. Now it is costing 96 rupees per liter as per government regulations, right? Government put a regulation that it can cost only below 100 rupees. So that is why now the hand sanitizer cost, they had to reduce because the raw material cost went down. So there are many variables due to which they usually change the price.
So the next question is, what do you understand by demand of a product is price elastic?
Okay. Demand of a product is price elastic. Now suppose the price of a product is today 10 rupees. If the price is reduced to 8 rupees, the demand is more, then in that case, that is called price elastic. The price is elastic in nature. As you reduce the price, the demand is increasing, right? If you reduce the price or you increase the price, there is no change in demand, then in that case, that price is called inelastic in nature. I gave you the example of commodities. Commodities like petrol, the price of petrol, suppose goes up by 4 rupees. Will you use less petrol? Usually that don't happen, right? You'll buy petrol only, right? If the product like, suppose ice cream, the price of ice cream was 100 rupees earlier, now they reduced it to 50 rupees. You bought more, you were never interested in buying an ice cream. Now looking at less price at a mall, you saw that the price is only 50 rupees, you'll go for it, right? right? So the price is elastic in that case. So usually all those products were not essential, in those cases the price is highly elastic. Prestige goods, yes, definitely. I gave you example of Mercedes car, right? The car segment, those are prestige goods. Your wristwatch segment, like Rolex watch, you are buying. Rolex watch is costing, suppose, 1.5 lakh rupees. Still people are buying. Those are prestige goods. And in that case, in prestige goods, they usually keep a very high price to maintain the prestige. Because what happens, people, they identify the customer of those segment where those people are not very much interested in going down. For example, tomorrow Mercedes will be available at 5 lakh rupees. What will happen? So many people, even I will buy one Mercedes, right? I bought a Maruti. Rather than buying a Maruti, I'll go for Mercedes because Mercedes is a prestige status, right? But what will be the loss for the company? The high value people who were buying Mercedes at 50 lakh rupees, they will not buy any more Mercedes. Did you understand? So it's a very interesting strategy with prestige good usually made. Okay, markup pricing. You are talking about markup pricing. Okay, fine. Now see, markup is usually the profit you want to book on the cost you are incurring, right? The cost, whatever the cost you are incurring, you want to book a profit markup on it, and the markup is the profit you want to book. Now suppose what is the cost? How can you find out? The cost is total cost. Total cost is equal to fixed cost plus variable cost, right? So the fixed cost is, suppose, a certain amount, 3 lakh rupees, and variable cost is 10 rupees per unit, right? And you want to book a profit of markup price, then in that case, markup price is equal to unit cost upon 1 minus desired return on sales, right? Desired return on sales means how much profit you want to book. Suppose 20% profit you want to book, so 1 minus 0.2, that is 0.8. So that is how you can find out markup price. Now again, with the markup price, after markup price, if you want to add, suppose, some other factors, then also you can add to it. Like there are so many other factors attached to a product, like promotional expenditures and all this. So those are all variable cost where you should include all this to find out what is the exact rate of return. And one more thing, let me clarify you. One more thing, very interesting thing, let me clarify you, that every industry has a standard markup. Every industry has a standard markup. Now, for example, in fast moving consumer goods, meaning bathing soap segment, hair oil segment, all these, kurkure, these soft drinks and all, these all FMCG segment, where the markup standard is usually a 35% return, usually that is the industry standard. So every industry has a particular industry standard markup. Why? They look at the possible losses possible. The possible losses in that particular industry, right? So every industry has a particular markup. If you are entering into that industry, you have to look into the industry standard. You cannot book profit 100% in that particular industry. You cannot keep a very high price for booking 100% profit. That is not feasible in a particular industry like FMCG, right? So if you keep low markup, then what will happen? You will be always at a risk end, right? That always keep you at a very risky zone. We'll discuss some other day about in some other topic about connecting this with the markup one. Hopefully everyone clear about their doubts.
So there is one question on sealed bid pricing. What is sealed bid pricing? Sealed bid
pricing. Okay, I could not take you through those different pricing strategies. There are different types of pricing strategy. One is called sealed bid pricing, auction pricing, Right. So there are various DOTS pricing, DOTS auction pricing, sealed bid pricing. When you know this government tender, in those government tender, what happens? Suppose for sanitization of secretariat, they want some sanitization company to give a bid. That what would be the total cost? They'll what would be the total price they'll charge for sanitization of secretariat? In that case, suppose 10 different companies who approached these secretariat. So they'll book, they'll mention the price in a sealed envelope, and they'll give it to the respective person, and the respective person will open the sealed tender, and then whatever the price, whoever has the lowest price, they'll do they are going to give the tender to that particular person. That is called sealed bid auction, right? There is something called English auction, there is something called Dutch auction. So there are different types of auction type pricing also are there. I have not taken you through that, but again, thank you for asking this question. I could discuss with you that if you want to know about English auction, Dutch auction and all, then also a little bit one small idea that when one seller and many buyers are there, then that is called English auction, right? One seller and many buyer is there, then that is called English auction. So they usually keep a low, usually the auctioneer announces high price for a product and then slowly they decrease the price. They usually announce very high price for the product and then slowly decrease the price. That is called English auction. But in case of Dutch auction, what's happened? One seller, many buyer, and or one buyer, many seller. Right. Usually the auctioneer, the previous case I told you about Dutch auction, where they keep a high price and they gradually reduce, that is called Dutch auction. And English auction, what happens? They usually keep at a very low price and then they gradually go up as per the buyers. If buyers are charging, saying that if the product is costing 10 rupees, it is mentioned in the website that it is costing 10 rupees only. One more buyer is coming and saying that I will buy it at 12 rupees, the price will go up. One more buyer will come and quote it at 14 rupees, the price will go up. So this is how the auction pricing happens.
So there is another question on FAS.
FAS?
That is primarily used for.
So it is free alongside.
Okay, FAS, free alongside pricing.
Yes, sir. It is just like, you know, the difference between free on board and free alongside.
Yes. Free alongside pricing and customer segment pricing. There are okay. I have not taken you through all those segments. Again, I have to discuss with you the entire concept of it. Free alongside pricing. Basically, what happens when you go to a mall? In a mall, when you look into different product pricing, you look at that there are certain product which is at suppose 20% discount. You go to that shelf, and then you find out there are so many related products which is also kept over there, and the pricing of those products are not 20% discount. This there is a particular product which is 20% discount, another product which is 15% discount. Likewise, you know, depending on the reference pricing, then keep a free alongside pricing. So these are there are various again different techniques for these pricing strategies, which is the latest pricing strategies. I've not got time to discuss the entire details.
Thank you so much, sir. There is another question. There is a numerical, I believe. Alok Tripathi, you can use the formula that was discussed by Dhananjay sir, and you can solve the problem. Then there is another return on capital employed, or there is a finance related terminology. So we'll talk about that in the financial management class. It is already time. So I take this opportunity to thank all the participants and the resource person for the day, Dr. Dhananjay Beura. He has been absolutely brilliant to explain all the very difficult, complex looking numericals, formula and concepts. He has simplified and gave very pertinent examples. So I request my dear colleague Srimay sir to say a few words, then we get into the concluding part of the session. Over to Srimay sir.
Thank you, Dr. Anshuman Jena. I was totally in the class. It was absolutely wonderful explanation of everything. I congratulate Dr. Beura. He made all those explanation of all those details very black and white. And I hope all those learners, they will be able to make their clear all those doubts they have. And because this pricing decisions, it is very important because it is very much related to the revenue generation, or it is very much related to the long run survival of a particular company. So really Dr. Beura has enlightened the different sides of the pricing decisions, what kind of pricing a particular organization has to take, because as a customer, when we go to market, we don't know how this price is set, whether it is psychological pricing or how much markup is there. We are unable to calculate or work on that, but company has to do, because they have to survive in the long run, and it is done through the pricing policy. So I would like to thank Dr. Beura on behalf of learners and OSOU. Again, it is over to Dr. Anshuman Jena.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. I also thank you and Dr. Dhananjay for this successful session. I can never thank all the participants enough for being so patient while listening to the talk of Dr. Beura, while asking questions. So many very interesting and relevant questions were asked. I thank all the participants for making this session very, very interesting and interactive through their questions. Thank you so much. And I have already shared a link to share your feedback about the session. Kindly click on the link before you leave this particular session, or else the data will be lost. So please share your feedback. These feedbacks are absolutely valuable for us. It will help us to improve and give you better services. Thank you, Dr. Beura. Okay. If you have any last concluding words or sentences or statement, please go ahead, sir.
Thank you. Thank you so much, sir. Dr. Anshuman Jena, Dr. Srimay sir. Thank you for giving me this opportunity. I'm delighted to see the kind of audience you have. Very interesting question they're asking, and the kind of involvement they have. I was not expecting that. This is my first experience with your university, but I'm really delighted to see the kind of audience, the kind of engagement, the kind of involvement they have, the understanding they have. So hopefully I will look forward for opportunities to discuss with this audience again and again. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. We also definitely look forward to your further sessions, and we also request all the participants to please regularly visit our website. Each and every details related to the online counseling sessions are already uploaded at least before 24 hours time. So please visit. You will find detailed information of all the sessions along with the joining link. You can join any session as per your convenience. Thank you so much, each and everyone, for your involvement, participation and passion. Thank you. And this is the official announcement that the session ends here. May I please request each and everyone who is listening and who is connected at this very moment to kindly disengage from the platform. Please log out. The session ends here. Thank you so much. Please give feedback. Please disengage.